Father, thank you for what you have for us today. We hear it, we believe it, we receive it, that we may be a doer of it. You increase, we decrease. Father, have your way, we pray in Jesus' name. It's like the story of this missionary, you know, he would put his Bible down like this and he would just, you know, and he would say, it's alive, it's alive, it's alive, it's alive, it's alive. So everybody from all the villages would come and just go, I don't see anything moving. What is he talking about? So they would all get closer and then he would tell them, about the Word of God. Well, for us in our lives, you don't realize it, but other people are gonna, they're starting to dance around you, like, because in everything that you do now, you are saying, it's alive, it's alive, it's alive. We're becoming a doer of the Word. We're becoming a doer of the Word. Oh! It's one thing to hear it, one thing to believe it, one thing to receive it, but a whole different thing when you start being a doer of the Word. That other people, they don't just hear you say that you believe in God, but they start seeing it in what you say, in what you do, the way you walk, the way you talk. They're looking at you like he is alive. Amen? So turn to Hebrew. Whew. Book of Hebrew. This is the year of the sword of the Lord. My God. You know Gideon, when Gideon war, he said, the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. And actually, before I go to Hebrew, if you make a left, since you're in the neighborhood, in Ephesians chapter 6, when we talk about the armor of God, verse 17 reads, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. It's our offensive, it's our sword. The sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. Of course, this is not the Logos, this is the Rhema, Word of God. Inspired, breathed. It's a now word for whatever you need. It's a beautiful thing to see that it's the sword of the Holy Spirit. Because to me, I don't know your relationship with the Holy Spirit, but oh, precious Holy Spirit, I think of him as, you know, the dove and the rain and the water and gentleness and love. And but he has a sword, the sword of the Holy Spirit. Whoo! He knows how to bring forth the sword that cuts. I remember when I first got born again and the word was released and I heard it, it was like a knife that was suddenly bringing conviction, like it was alive. Like it wasn't a word that I would hear. It was just like, Have you ever been there? Not just at salvation, but every moment of our lives. That you will hear a word and you will be sitting in the service or reading your Bible or whatever you're doing. And you will just feel it and you will just, you know, if you're in church, you're like going straight ahead, looking straight ahead. You have tears all over your eyes. You just feel like everybody's going to look at me. What's happening to me? It's the sword of the Holy Spirit. But at the same time here, he says, now you take it. See, it's easier for me if it's the sword of the Holy Spirit because then it's not my responsibility. Because we as children of God, as we becoming a doer of the word, we we're starting to understand more and more that God can do things all by himself, but many times he uses us. Right? And we want the anointing, but we just want God to anoint everything in our lives, and we just watch him do everything, but he's like, no, that's not the way it is. Because you're my representative. So I want things to start being released to you. So now you take the sword of the Spirit. And that's what's so humbling. Yeah, it's because, no, I'm like, God, don't give it to me. Yeah, I mean, if you can look at yourself and understand that 99.99.110%, you'll fall short. So you're like, no, don't give it to me. But like he's teaching all of us. No, I want it. I'm going to teach you what you can do in my name. I'm going to teach you that it's the sword of the Lord and of Gideon. That what I'm calling you to do, I'm anointing you to do, not on your own strength, but my strength will enable you to do what I'm telling you to do. I tell you to clean your house, well, you have to show up and stand there with a broom. Yeah. Nothing's going to get done. You can tell everybody, you know, I've been anointed to clean my house. And they say, yeah, and you think God's going to come inside your house and it's done? Oh, wouldn't that be wonderful? God, clean my house, fix my dinner. But the Lord doesn't move like that. Right. He wants us to take the step. Yeah, because the step shows our surrendered heart, our willing heart. Yeah. And in the case of being in warfare, how true that is. Yeah. That he wants us to be able to believe and trust the word of God, the sword of the Spirit. So now go to Hebrew. Whew, I just got hot suddenly. It's not a hot flash. Maybe it is. I'm thinking it's the Holy Ghost. So let me pray about it. Hot flash or Holy Ghost? I'm going with the Holy Ghost. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Amen? I'll drink some water. Oh, and I got another sword that's not as heavy. Where is my sword? The other one was so heavy I couldn't hit you with it. But this one is good. Deacon Leroy found this. It's for 3-year-old, so he thought I can. Thank you. So he thought I can get that one for Pastor. She won't hurt nobody. Because last week I had seen myself putting it on your shoulder. So today I'll slack you. On your shoulder. But Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, for the word of God, my God, 4:12, familiar passage. It says different thing about the word of God, the sword of the Spirit, the Holy Spirit who breathed upon the word, who breathed upon you, the Holy Spirit that's bringing it, the word in our life. My God, the Holy Spirit cannot do anything apart from the word. And there, here it says, for the word of God is living. It's alive. It's alive. And it says, not only it's alive, which means every time that you need to believe the manifestation of the life of God, the divine life in every area of your life, even every place that you go, when other words are being increased and you don't know which way to go, and you believe that the word is the way, the truth, and the life, then it's the word that we need. Yeah. Because the Word is alive. The Word works. The Word knows how to bring forth things in order. It's the Word. It's the Word. Even if you don't memorize the Word, write down the scriptures that you know you need. Hallelujah. It's the Word. The Holy Spirit cannot do anything apart from the Word. You understand? It's God. The sword of the Holy Spirit. I just had to stop there, but there it says, and it's powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of the soul and the spirit and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. And there is no creature hidden from his sight, but all things are naked and open to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Wow. So not only it's living, but it says it's powerful. There is nothing more powerful if you're in any situation that you can use than the Word of God. The Holy Spirit, he has a way from glory to glory to just give you one word. He doesn't need a whole lot of word. I'm not talking about you knowing, you know, no, I'm just talking one word. One word led by the Holy Spirit that he shows you to bring forth will just come and pierce everything that needs to be pierced, penetrates. Only he can go to the depth of our heart, of our mind. Only he knows everything there is to know about us. Isn't it amazing to see that he says that all things are naked unto him? He sees everything. He knows all things. We could put on the projector every thought that you ever had. And everybody would run out of the church. We're so used to even accept people based on what we know or not about them. And suddenly we hear something about them and, oh, well, I don't like her anymore. I don't like him anymore. We need to trust God, who knows how to divide things that even the people do not know how to divide. Because here it says he's able to divide, piercing the division, the New King James says, but I believe the King James says the dividing and the New King James the division. I don't like the word division because it sounds like things are separated. The dividing means to be able to discern what's what. Yeah. To be able to discern what's of the spirit and what's of the soul. Yeah. Oh, how we need the Word to divide and discern and break forth things that we'll be able to see everything in our life. What's of the spirit and what's of the flesh. But he does it in us from glory to glory. And he does it with so much love. And he brings the truth. And he just does like a shift that suddenly our mind is renewed. Because our mind is renewed by the Word of God. Everything is by the Word of God, led by the Spirit. We cannot separate the Word and the Spirit. There's some people, they focus too much on the Word, not understanding that without the Spirit, you don't have the Word. But the Spirit, that's there to just be able to take people to a place of transformation, knows how to make the difference, to make the dividing between the soul and the spirit, which is like the joints and the marrow. The joints is what's on the outside. It's your bones. The marrow is what's on the inside of the bone. What you see and what you don't see. An army that's being raised up, not just to be immovable and be able not to become deserter, so to speak, but to be able to recognize deception. And to stand with the Word of God and to say what the Word says. The marrow is inside the bone. It's what's not seen, like the spirit you cannot really see who you are in Christ. Yes. The Word brings that alive. Yeah, have you ever been in a place that you were penetrated by the Word of God? I mean, literally, that it just hit you. In a way that you couldn't explain it to people, but yet we try. You know, we tell other people, did you see what the Word said? Yeah. And they're looking at you like, yeah. Because the moment you heard it, it became alive to you. Yeah, but it might not be alive to them. Yeah, because the things of the Spirit are not understandable by the natural man. So you could try to speak the Word to people who do not understand it, but we are learning to be able to release it every place we are to speak life, whether people understand it or not. Because the moment you speak it forth to someone, you're planting a seed, the incorruptible seed of life. I love the scripture, you know, the psalm says that the Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my back. So just try to picture it, that it's a lamp unto my feet. I don't have a cord to put it under my feet, but it's a lamp unto my feet. But it's also a light unto my back. So try to picture it. It's not the same thing, you understand? It's a light onto my path to where I'm going. But as I walk and I'm going, it's also a lamp onto my feet. So that it's two ways. The Word works for you, but also to be a doer of it and release it. So it's a light unto my feet that God is able to bring a word to me when I need it, to lead me and guide me and direct me in all places. And no offense to counselors and Pastor Chuck, you are awesome. Praise you for what you do. But what you do it by the Holy Spirit. But I'm telling you that apart from the Holy Spirit that brings forth the Word, you might not know where you're going. But at the same time as I'm going and he's a lamp onto my feet, that means that where I'm going, I'm bringing the Word with me. That what the way that I walk brings the light, his glory, for others to see. Another way to tell it would be, you know, thank you, Father, for bringing the Word that set me free from alcoholism. But now I'm free from alcoholism, but now I come and I come against alcoholism. Thank you for the healing Word that I am healed from cancer, but now I'm coming the offensive and I come against cancer. In Jesus' name. I thank you that I am free from the spirit of lust. But in the name of Jesus, I come against the spirit of lust in Jesus' name. It's the difference that you rebuke things by moving. We call it the Zorro sword. So you rebuke like that. But sometimes the enemy, Zorro, I don't know if somebody, Zorro. That the way? Zorro. I probably need to get a cap at some point. But Zorro, so you rebuke to the level that you submit. Submit to God, his authority, his word. Submit to God, resist the devil. But now the Lord is taking the whole body of Christ to another place. Because you can rebuke. But now he says, enforce what I have done. Release my word. Speak my word. Yeah. Rebuke those things that have set you free. Now use your sword, because the moment that you're free from something in your life, you know how to use that word, because it became rhema word for you. Yeah. If the Lord helped you see some freedom in your family, in your son or in your daughter, you have by the Spirit a revelation and ability to rebuke things of people's life for their children like nobody else can. Because suddenly you have compassion, you have fire, because you know that it's not a word that you know in your head, but it's a word that you know in your heart. It's piercing. It separates what's seen and unseen. It says here that it is powerful. We don't realize how powerful it is. I believe that it would change so many of our situation and conversation if people would just add the word. Just add the word. With you in your marriages, in your lives, in your, just add the word, because whatever you say doesn't have any power. Hello. You can have a whole thing of just whatever you think. The government is on the shoulder of our Lord, our King. He said to pray, let the kingdom come, let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And he wants us to start releasing life and speak life. No, you will not die. You will live. I rebuke sickness in Jesus' name. Amen? So we submit to God. And when we submit to God, we under his authority and we move in another level of authority. But that authority comes with responsibility. I was walking around in my neighborhood and I didn't have this, but I had the word of God. And I was walking and I was releasing the word of God and speaking life. Hallelujah. Because I know his word is powerful. You know why? Because God says in Isaiah 55 that it will not return to him void. It's so powerful. I know we all believe that, but we need to believe it even to another level. People look at the Bible like a religious exercise, like I have to read my Bible. It's not what it is. No. I want to learn the tactics. I want to know what I'm supposed to do. I want to believe you, Father, to be able to hear what word do I need to war. And it could be one scripture that the Holy Spirit gives you. Oh, stand on that scripture. Put it in your car. Put it in your dashboard. Just speak it out loud. War with the word. Release the word of God. When the Holy Spirit moves, there's always a word that he brings to show you something in your life. You know, it's like David when Nathan came and he tells David, well, you're the man. Yeah. You know, David, he comes to David and he says, yeah, you know this guy, he committed adultery and he killed and he did all this thing. And, you know, David's like, let's slap the guy. Yeah. Who is he? Where is he? Let's whoop, cut his head off. And he looked at David and he says, you're the man. Says, you're the man. Because the Holy Spirit has a way to use the word to divide some things in between your will and your mind and your emotion and to cut it from what's of the Spirit, that you will be able to make the difference in what's of God and what's of you. But he will also show you what's of you and help bring forth healing in your life. He never shows you anything in a way that it's to make you feel worse. It's always healing. Never forget that. God is a good God. He's not going to show you something just to hit you upside your head. No, the enemy is the accuser of the brethren, always making you feel less than and beating you up. And no. The Lord, he already took care of death. So he's not going to bring death on you or any evil thing to say, here, I'm going to teach you a lesson. He said, no, believe my word. Believe what I have done on the cross. And force what I have done on the cross. I love you. I'm going to show you, and I'm going to put you in a place that you're going to rest in my word. I'm going to show you what needs to be changed. And the moment I reveal to heal, but I also reveal to overthrow, to overturn. I also reveal to bring forth the sword and just cut some things all around you. Oh, my God, what a blessed, blessed, blessed God that we have. And he says in verse 14, he says, seeing then that we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who cannot sympathize with our weaknesses, but was in all points tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace, that we may obtain mercy and find grace to help in time of need. Well, who here doesn't have a need? Who here doesn't see a need around us? So I'm thinking, I'm going to obey the word and do what the word says. I'm not going to look at my weaknesses, and I'm not going to look at the way I am in the natural, because he put this sword in my hand. I'm going to go to him, because I know that Jesus can understand everything that I have gone through, because he picked it up. He carried my sin. He carried my shame. He carried my soul. He took it all on the cross. Hallelujah. And now he says, no, you just come boldly. Boldly, because you trust that I'm going to give you what you need to war with. You come knowing that you're going to receive the grace and the word in your time of need. Come unto me. Come unto me so I can give you my word. Come unto me so that my word can be made alive in you. Sometimes you don't even have to open the Bible. You're sitting somewhere in a circumstance, and it could be any kind of trial, and your mate is having a PMS. PMS came to my mind because I'm hot. You're having a... A powerful, majestic, let me see, PMS. You're having a powerful, majestic situation. And when that happens, all the men are looking at me like we know exactly what you mean. When that happens, when anything happens in our life, when we say, no, let's go to God. Let's believe his word. Let's go to the throne of grace with boldness. Do you know how many people argue and go to a whole bunch of things before they go to the Lord? Where people, families, nowadays, they don't all open the word together. It would change families. No wonder the enemy took the Bible out of school. Because it's life. But now the children are going to school with a lamp onto their feet. But how are they going to hear it unless they hear it at home if mommy and daddy never open the word? And I'm not talking about you, I'm talking in general. Yeah. Amen. But if it's only on Sunday morning, you know, where did I put my Bible? Yeah, it got really quiet. Because we need to keep the word in our heart. We need to be able to speak the word to our children. That's why children love to come here to the children's ministry. They are doing a wonderful job with the children. It changes life because then they go back home and they say, Mommy, Daddy, we need to go to church. Saturday night, they go to bed earlier. Amen? We have a responsibility. We carry the word of life. We need to start speaking it and go to the Lord and believe that He wants to give us solution for everything that we need. And we can speak forth what the word says about some stuff. Not all, not what we want it to say. The Bible in Genesis said all herbs are good. It doesn't mean we should all get high. In Timothy said a glass of wine is good every day. It doesn't mean that it tells you to drink wine every day. The word is there to critique and convict us, not the other way around. Because otherwise we can find whatever we want in this word. So that's why not only the word is the sword of the Holy Spirit, so the Holy Spirit, he's the one that brings you the word, but you know what He does, precious Holy Spirit? He also instructs us and teaches us the word. When you first open the word, you might not understand a thing that it says. For some people, they might hear the word and it means nothing because they don't understand and they don't have the Holy Spirit. But once you're born again and the word is living in your heart, the Holy Spirit that is carrying the word, the sword, and He says, here, now you take it. But He says you take it, but He's still behind you. He's still with you. He's still in you. Well, He's also there to teach you. Many of you remember that when you finally learned that before you read your Bible, you pray, you know, for the Lord to teach you what it says. People ask me all the time, what version of the Bible should I get? I said, the Holy Spirit one. Doesn't matter if it's NLT, NKV, KV, whatever. We pray, Holy Spirit, this is your sword. Lead me, guide me, show me, teach me what I need to know. And always help me remain teachable. Never, never, never read a scripture and tell yourself, well, I know Hebrew chapter 4, 12 and 13. I know it by heart. Because this morning, I believe that we heard what we had heard before, but we heard it again. And faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And it's better to hear the same scripture that the Lord shows you every day, 10,000 times a day. That's why in the foyer we have all the scriptures of who you are in Christ. And I give it to people, and I say, this is Dr. J giving that to you. Read this out loud 3 times a day, like a regular doctor. We take all these pills, don't we? Well, I hope we don't, but every day, if you need healing in your body, we have a little booklet with all the healing scriptures. If you're fearful, we have a booklet with all the scriptures, and not just here, but it's easy to find. You can go to Mr. Google for that. Even though I believe thou shalt not Google. We could go to Mr. Google for things like that. Scriptures on healing. And then you print it and you put it somewhere and you don't read it quietly. But you remember it's a light onto your path, but it's a lamp onto your feet. So then you read it and you speak it forth. And then once you heal, you rebuke sickness in Jesus' name. It's not enough to believe the word just for me, myself, and I, the wrong Trinity. We have to be a doer of the word and release it everywhere we go. When you take your children to school, thank you that you are their provider. Thank you that there's angels encamped around them. When you go to your work, thank you, Father, I believe that you brought me this work, this job, and that no weapons formed against me shall prosper. Thank you today that I'm walking in this job with your word upon my feet. And because I am here, some people are going to see you that couldn't see you before. My God. And then we start worrying like never before. What situation are we in that we need today to be schlagging? We need to be schlagging. We need to rebuke every word that's not of God. We need to release the word of God like never before. And we need to do it trusting him by going to the throne of grace. It says, I love this because it says to come boldly to the throne of grace. And it says, it doesn't say so that maybe we could obtain mercy and find grace. No, it shows you the purpose of going there. The power of prayer. You know what the Holy Spirit does when you don't have time to open your Bible? He opens in you what he has placed in you. He opens in you what he has placed in you. It's the sword of the Holy Spirit. That's why it says in Ephesians, praying in the Spirit. Because many of us have been in times that we were so sick in the natural that if somebody came to the hospital or to your home and said, why don't you just open the Bible? You would be like, seriously? If I could open the Bible, I would already have done it. There's some times that in your physical strength you can't. Or you can be in a situation that you don't have time because you're in a whirlwind of some sort. But the Holy Spirit has a way to open up what he has placed inside of you. And he'll bring forth life upon it in such a way that you will know for yourself that you're able now to discern what's of the Spirit and what's of you. But because most of the time it's something that you didn't even know you knew. He just, he shines the light. And he does that in front of you in your life. And he also does it through you. That's the lamp unto your feet. He'll give you a scripture for somebody you don't even remember where it is, what it is. You don't even know it exactly. You know what I mean? And suddenly you say, well, the Bible says that Jesus understands and he sympathizes with you. It's the lamp unto your feet for other people. We need to march forth and just completely now be on the offensive and release things for other people around us. But you know what stops us is that we don't walk boldly because we're looking in the natural at our weaknesses. Amen. The sword of the Lord and of Gideon. But Gideon, because of the Lord, is able to move forward. Amen? To do what God calls him to do. So are we. I believe, like you do, that the word is what helps us stand. When every other word comes just coming at you from all directions. The Lord told us he's going to speak loud and clear. He's bringing this word to draw people to kind of to tune in to him. To come boldly. To believe that his word is alive. One word is all you need. One word. And today, I believe that the Lord is going to not just give you one word, but he's going to remind you of a word that he already gave you. And you war with that word. When your children don't appear to walk in salvation, me and my house shall be saved. I rebuke what's causing them to be lost in Jesus' name. Amen. I remember when I had an encounter with the Holy Spirit. You know, you have encounters different as you go from glory to glory. But I remember that I cried for 1 week. 1 week, there's tears. And it was beautiful because I couldn't remember when I had cried before. You remember when you go through things, you can get to a place that you don't cry anymore? Can I get an witness? the precious Holy Spirit, it's like he was making everything alive in me. It's like he was just completely, I could see things in me with so much love. I don't know how to explain. Who knows what I mean? That he penetrated, and the tears were healing tears, and he emptied me, and he filled me, and it was like becoming alive. And his word is incorruptible. And right after that, I go into a church, and somebody said, if you bring $100, that word will become alive in you. Bring $100 to receive that word. And I was sitting down, and I felt the opposite of what I had felt. I was discerning between the soul and the spirit, because what wasn't of God, instead of coming with love and answered, it came with condemnation, and it didn't sound like the Lord at all. And I said, oh Lord, what are you showing me? And he says, never forget, the word that I have put in you is incorruptible. It cannot be bought. It cannot be bought. It cannot be merchandised. Never forget. He said, it's just like the anointing. He said, it can never be, never be merchandised. And I believe personally that the word that's incorruptible, that's in you, is the proof to you that you are born again. And if you believe that you are born again, Ephesians says to take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit. Some people do not know how to use the sword of the Spirit because they look at their weaknesses and start wondering, well, maybe I don't have the helmet on. No, no, you have the word in you. It's incorruptible. And Father is watching over his word to perform it in you, through you, and it will not return to him void. He plants the seed in you. You become an incredible vessel of glory, and he who began a good work in you, will perfect it until the day of Jesus Christ. And the Holy Spirit, he just wants you to believe in him, who he is, what God has done, and he wants you to stand strong with boldness, immovable, believing in the power of the living word. In the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God. And the word became flesh. Hallelujah. And now the word is becoming flesh through us like never before. We will not walk in self-deception. We will be a doer of the word. Stand to your feet. Hallelujah. And with boldness this morning. Whoo! Say, Father, thank you. I am born again. Born of the Spirit. Born of the incorruptible seed of the Word. And I thank you today. I am born again because I believe that you sent Jesus, your only begotten Son, to die on the cross for my sins. He rose on the third day. He's alive in me. He's alive. And his word, the precious word, is alive in me. Because he's the living word. And I believe it. I receive it. And even in my weaknesses, today, we come boldly to the throne. And we ask you for mercy, for grace. This is our time of need. Move, Father. Help us. War with your word. We rebuke Jesus' name. And we release the word of God in every situation. In Jesus' name. Amen.